Welcome to Chubb Global Insights. I'm David Furby. Today, my guest is Lord Charles Powell, a British diplomat, businessman, and advisor to Chubb. Lord Powell, you were private secretary and advisor on foreign affairs and defence to two UK prime ministers, Margaret Thatcher and John Major. You left number 10 Downing Street in 1992 after 9 years and have since served as a board member of several major international companies, as well as being an independent member of the House of Lords. Thank you for joining me today in these unusual times when we are both conducting this interview from our homes during lockdown.
Well, David, it's nice to be with you.
Let's start with Brexit. Now that the UK has left the EU and a trade deal negotiated, what does the landscape look like? And what are the risks and opportunities for both the UK and multinational businesses?
The answer is it's a bit early to tell yet about the implications and consequences of Brexit. You may remember that the Chinese Premier, Zhou Enlai, was once asked what he felt about the consequences of the French Revolution. And he said, well, it's a bit early to tell. Well, we shan't need 200 years to tell about Brexit, but we probably need a year or two before we can really, really understand the consequences. That, in a way, has been amplified by the coronavirus, because that has made life so different and so difficult in the short term. And it's a bit hard to disentangle what's the consequence of the virus and what's the consequence of Brexit itself. But having said that, there's some things are pretty clear. It's not the end of the world, and it's not salvation. It's somewhere in between. It's pretty clear that the British economy will, over the next few years, be smaller than it would otherwise have been, by which I mean it won't perhaps necessarily grow as fast as it might have done otherwise, because of the interruption of the trade flows and the ability of people to travel as easily as in the past. So that will be different. And companies will need time to understand how to adapt to the new situation. They need to understand the very complex rules and regulations about trading with the rest of Europe. And the same will be true of European companies trying to trade with the UK. So I suppose what I'm saying is there's going to be a shakedown period, which might last anything up to a year, while people readjust. One thing that I would say, and this actually struck me as really rather interesting, is that after years of Brexit being on the front page of every newspaper just about every day, you have to search through to page 5 or 6 these days to find any reference to Brexit. I mean, it's all about the virus, or it's all about Harry and Meghan or something like that. But Brexit has faded as a sort of daily issue. And that itself is quite interesting, because it suggests, I say, no panic, but things need adjusting rather than cataclysmic change.
You mentioned that the British economy is going to, in all likelihood, shrink in the coming years. The City of London and Wall Street have been the world's leading financial centres. What do you see for the future of the City of London post-Brexit?
Let me first just correct one point. I didn't say it would shrink. I said it wouldn't grow as fast, and that as a result, it would probably be 3 or 4% smaller, let's say, in 10 years' time than it would otherwise have been. So I don't think we're not waving goodbye to growth. But people took a conscious decision by a small majority. They took a decision. They preferred to regain more of their national sovereignty than grow as fast as they might otherwise have done. And you have to respect that decision. The Remainers hated it, but that was what the majority wanted. Now, coming on to the city, well, of course, the city is a hugely sophisticated, well-developed institution. It's built up over centuries. It has enormous networks, not just in London itself, but of course with Europe and the United States, Japan, Hong Kong. London is a global market. Nowhere else in Europe is a global financial market. Oh, they would like to be, but they aren't yet. And let me just tell you one small fact. More people work in the small square mile of the City of London than live in the whole of Frankfurt. Now that tells you something. That tells you about the concentration of skills and abilities that exist in the City of London. That's not going to change. if the Europeans want to make difficulties on financial services, well, maybe they will, to try to regain a bit more of the business for themselves. But I'm absolutely confident that London will remain one of the four global financial centres, alongside New York, alongside Tokyo, and alongside Hong Kong.
More broadly, relating to the UK, what part should the UK play on the world stage?
Well, that's a very big issue, and it's actually quite a good time to ask it, because the British government published just 2 days ago what it calls the Integrated Review of Foreign and Defence Policy. And this is aiming to set out what Britain will look like in the world after Brexit. The tagline is, we're going to be global Britain. Not precisely clear what that means, but it means, I think, that we have to look not just to Europe, but to the whole world. Though I would say we've been doing that anyway. It'll become perhaps more of a necessity. So I believe that Britain will continue to play a role in the politics, security, and defence of the world, alongside the United States above all. They are, after all, our closest partner. And amongst their partners, we are the only one with the same degree, or with a sufficient degree of sophistication in our defense, our military equipment, and everything like that. And if I was being slightly simplistic about it, I would say, well, the United States is the world sheriff. Britain will continue to be the deputy sheriff, because that suits our instincts. We've always been outward looking. We've always been involved right round the world, and still are through the Commonwealth and many other ways. So Britain will still be a very active world power. Of course, it doesn't have the weight, scale, and size of the United States or of China, or indeed of the European Union. But we do still have the instincts and the ambitions to play a global role. Do you know, I don't really see those quite so much in the European Union. Of course, it's going to be great in its economic size and its trade reach, that too. But it doesn't really have that sense of destiny which drives Britain and always has done, and the sense of ambition. So for me, we are going to go on playing a leading and active role in the world. And of course, trade and business will be a very, very big part of that. Trade with every part of the world. We'll be signing up trade agreements wherever we can and expanding our exports, not just of goods, but above all of services.
Given that context, just how damaging is the UK's exit to the EU?
So I don't think the EU is going to find, in an economic sense, that the difficulties are really noticeable. Where I think they will find a bigger difference is in the whole defence security role and the foreign policy role. I think it's fair to say that Britain has always been at the forefront of foreign policy in Europe since it joined the EU, precisely for the reasons I've already given. We're used to thinking globally. We're used to acting globally. In defence, we are, amongst all the European members of NATO, the one who spends most on defence and the one who has the most sophisticated equipment and so on. It's a bit the same on the intelligence side. We are certainly better at intelligence than any of the European countries are. They're going to be weakened by our departure, unless they're prepared to bring us back in some of their institutions and the way they do these things. So it's not so much the economic side where they're going to miss Britain. It's going to be on police, intelligence, security, and defence.
What about businesses? What about multinational companies looking to invest in Europe? How should they be thinking with the current landscape of, you know, a combative trade position and these local spats that are happening at the moment?
I believe that the level of investment will increase. What will deter it, if anything does, will be additional regulatory burdens in Europe which discourage foreign investment from anywhere. It doesn't have to be Britain. It can be from any part of the world. And that's always a bit of a risk at Europe. It's not been as good at lightening and easing regulation as we have. They need to learn from that, to be perfectly honest. There's a great tendency in Brussels to add complicated regulation to so much of business. And that'll damage them more than anyone else.
I'm going to ask you to look into your crystal ball and ask, what does the EU look like in 10 years' time?
You'll see Europe develop differing levels of membership. Some countries will go the whole way. They'll go for a European-wide budget, a European finance ministry, and so on, but not all of them. There'll be others who will remain in a, you could call it an outer circle or a lower level, whatever. So it'll become a more varied institution instead of one single entirely cohesive block. And I suspect that is the way it will go. That would be my vision of it. It won't be a single colossus, nor will it start to break up, but it will be a mixed organization, different levels of cooperation. And interestingly, you know, that is what the vision of Margaret Thatcher was about Europe, which she delivered many, many years ago in the Bruges speech, a Europe which had kept some powers for the individual member states, handed over to Europe what we could do better together than individually, but not hand over all powers. So maybe that will actually, in the end, come true, even though Margaret Thatcher won't sadly be there to see it.
You have a unique perspective on that famous moment when she delivered that Bruges speech in 1988. Some have heralded that as the moment the UK was put on the path to Brexit. Would you agree with that?
Margaret Thatcher's Bruges speech did not set off Brexit. What it tried to do was to describe a different vision for Europe. A Europe where I've just said, which kept more national powers but worked together, where you could do things more effectively together. A Europe which made much greater efforts to be a free trader and maintain a great relationship across the North Atlantic with the United States. A Europe which brought in the East European countries, who at that stage was still under communism, and made them part of this wider Europe. That's what the Bruges speech was about. Nothing to do with leaving Europe. Now, obviously, some of the same people who were very unhappy with the way that the European Union worked went on to become Brexiteers and to campaign for us to leave altogether. But that was never her vision nor her idea.
I'd like to come back to the pandemic and ask you politically and for businesses, what are the biggest lessons learned during the course of the pandemic?
Well, there are so many. Where does even one start? Pandemic, of course, underline risk and the importance of being able to assess risk properly. Let's face it, we were all caught unawares by the pandemic, which is strange because in our national security strategy, a pandemic was regarded as the second highest risk. I see countries becoming more nationalist as a result of the pandemic. I see government having a bigger role, expanding its role in the national life. I hope only temporarily, but at the moment it has to be. I mean, the vast funds which are being raised to cope with Brexit, that has to be done by government. It couldn't be done, possibly be done privately. And there are many other aspects which will change things for a while anyway. But for me, the best is to think positively about it. How do we get out of the present situation? And there are signs that we are, obviously, because of the vaccines in particular. How do we try to stop it happening again? And how do we get our businesses back on the front foot and get a return to world growth? And you're seeing plenty of evidence for that.
You've been the advisor to two prime ministers. If I was Boris Johnson, how would you be advising me?
Well, I would certainly be advising, avoid boosterism. Don't be too anxious to get out of all these restrictions and so on. Of course, everyone wants to get out of them. Of course, there's pressure to do so. But you've just got to be disciplined, keep the population disciplined until we are really sure that we can safely start to open up again and then do it a step at a time, which, to be fair, he's showing signs finally, belatedly perhaps, of doing. Schools are now open, and that's a good step, and it's a first step. But you know, everyone wants to go to the pub, but it's dangerous to go to the pub. People need to be reminded that it's dangerous to go to the pub when the virus is still around. And even big sports occasions or any big events where there are crowds are going to be dangerous. So you've got to be very slow, considered, and above all, take account of the scientific advice.
You mentioned the massive recovery funds that are being put in place, $1.9 trillion in the United States, 750 billion euros across the EU. Is a spend now, tax later the right approach?
I think it's an inevitable approach. I mean, you've got to spend now. There was just no alternative. Otherwise, our economies would have been completely flattened, as it were. It is the spending and the way the central banks have managed things generally. Indeed, I would say the central banks are probably the biggest heroes of this whole episode, because they've in a way thrown their traditional caution to the winds and done what had to be done. Whatever it takes has been the motto of central banks generally, and that had to be done. And when it comes to tax, I mean, you can't tax people when they're already flat on their back. You've got to wait for the recovery to start. But you should be looking ahead to paying through this through higher taxes at a point in the future once the recovery is underway. And people, I think, will understand the necessity of higher taxes at some point. Because even with all that's been done, all the money that's been spent, it can't go on forever. When I look at this, I say to myself, you know, what happens when we run out of money completely? So that is why it's important now to get the economies back on track, and then to know that you're going to have to move forward and recognize that fact and accept it politically and persuade people that taxes will be necessary in future to pay for what's been done.
The Bretton Woods Agreement brought stability to financial markets at a time of crisis. Is this another such moment?
Well, it's certainly a moment of crisis. Do we need another Bretton Woods system? No, I don't think we do. Because the cooperation financial level between governments and above all between central banks has been pretty good. And I think uprooting the whole system and designing something new would be a mistake. It would simply take away from what is being pretty successfully done. Having said that, there need to be changes within the Bretton Woods system. I mean, China is grossly underrepresented within the Bretton Woods system compared to the size of its economy. The system was designed at a time when China's economy was infinitely smaller, and it played no real part in the world economy at all. It was, you know, back in the days of Mao Zedong and so on. Now it obviously has to have a greater role there and play a generally more positive and active role in international finance. So that's simply got to be done. And governments, I'm sure, realize that. It's a question of how and when you do it. I'm not sure necessarily the United States is terribly keen on it, because, of course, it gains so much from the role of the dollar in the world economy. And it's not looking to have a rival in the Chinese yuan. Whether the Chinese are yet ready or even thinking about becoming a major player in a global currency, I don't know. You read reports of it sometimes. It seems unlikely to me. It's too early. But that may happen in the future.
How would you rate the contribution of multilateral organizations during the pandemic?
Well, pretty mixed. As I've said, the financial ones have done, I think, very well. The World Bank, the IMF, and the sort of main elements of the Bretton Woods system. There are other international organizations who I think have been shown to be rather lacking. One has been the World Health Organization, which has not distinguished itself. It was very slow to call a pandemic, to recognize there was a pandemic and to get people onto it. It was very slow to discover the origins of the pandemic. Indeed, it still hasn't done so conclusively. It has not been particularly fast in getting assistance to some of the poorer countries. The World Trade Organization has not flourished in this period. And I would have to say that's much more the fault of President Trump than it has to do with the World Trade Organization itself. But he clearly didn't like it, put a block on its operation, in effect.
Well, you referenced China, of course, and that's another topic for conversation. Can the U.S. Form a global alliance to tackle challenges with China?
We are not in a new Cold War. Alliances have that sort of military connotation. And this is not a military situation. It's much more a political and economic situation in which a new superpower is emerging and will continue to emerge if it grows economically at the same pace. And it's a question of how we adjust to the emergence of China. So what we've got to do is to galvanize the democracies to come together to promote, strengthen, and ensure our system still is the one which is most appreciated in most countries of the world. And there are ways that could now happen. And President Biden is quite sensibly looking at some of the principal countries in Asia to try to form a sort of cooperative relationship between them, India, Japan, South Korea, you could perhaps include Australia in that. And no doubt he'd want some of the bigger European countries to come in, but not as a military alliance. This is, as it were, in standing up for democracy, for standing up for running the world on the basis of accepted international rules, and not trying to ignore the rules or rewrite them in your own image, as China sometimes seems to be trying to do. That is, I think, a sensible task, and one which President Biden is taking a big step from the attitude towards China that President Trump had. So I hope he will succeed, and I believe he will get support, certainly from Britain, I would have thought from most of the European countries. We need to keep together, is my, I think, strongest message. Stick together.
How do Western companies position themselves in this landscape with regard to China?
I've been for 25 years a director of a big trading group called Jardine Matheson. They're Hong Kong-based. We were founded in 1832 in China, and here we are nearly 200 later, going strong. We have 470,000 employees. We do business all over Asia, but particularly in China. And in those nearly 200 years, we've seen everything. We've seen famine, we've seen a Boxer rebellion, we've seen rule by emperors, we've seen rule by, under a republic, we've seen the communism, we've seen a revolution. We are still doing business in China. You just need to keep your head down, don't get involved in the politics, and get on with doing business. And for all the rhetoric that you're seeing now between governments in the world, companies are investing in China. Americans are investing in China. Indeed, China's getting more foreign investment at the moment than it's ever had. The same, I think, will be with do with trade. The Chinese ain't stupid. They know that they need trade as well. They need investment. So much as they dislike criticism and hit back at it, they hit back at governments much more than they hit back at companies. But if you play within the rules, try and keep your Chinese partners in the rules, there is, of course, going to be a spectacular business to be done in China as we go forward. The Chinese economy is going to be the biggest in the world, probably by 2030. You can't ignore a market that size. On political grounds. Invest in it, invest in getting, in recruiting the sort of people who can speak Chinese, who can operate in China. There's plenty of good advice around from government institutions and independent institutions. I chaired for 10 years something called the China-Britain Business Council, where we could help companies because we knew the ropes in China. We could help them start relationships, meet potential clients and customers and that sort of thing. So it's not difficult. Of course, the noises off as governments clash are always slightly frightening and off-putting. And there is this tendency nowadays to put sanctions on at every turn, which I think is very negative. I mean, the widespread use of sanctions, particularly extraterritorial sanctions, that is, penalizing companies and countries other than the target. I think that's very negative indeed. So that adds an additional area of risk, and companies have to understand that very well. They have to know what they can do without falling foul of sanctions imposed, particularly by the United States. But again, it's doable, just requires attention to detail and understanding.
I've heard you reference this as Asia's century. So more broadly, how should business leaders be thinking about Asia as a region? Strategically,
business leaders should be thinking about Asia as the giant market of the future. Partly, of course, because China will become the world's biggest economy, but also if you look further south in Southeast Asia, the ASEAN, so-called ASEAN countries, they're now economically extremely important and powerful. They're bigger, let's say, than the Australian economy. And then there's Japan, always perhaps been slow growth in recent times. But this is going to be the big market of the future. The government talks about Britain making a tilt towards Asia. President Obama in his time talked about America pivoting towards Asia. And it really means getting Asia more in focus. And it involves every aspect of business. Above all, I suppose it involves supply chains, but it involves getting to know markets, it involves languages, all sorts of things. It's going to be, I think, a revolution for business to really benefit from the Asian market, because there's no turning back. I don't think Asia is going to sort of flare briefly and then the rocket's going to fall back to Earth. You could say that maybe Japan had some of those aspects. If some of us remember in the 1980s, all the talk was, when is Japan going to overtake the US? Well, thank you. When is it going to overtake the US? No time soon. But China is going to. And the combined force of Asia, when you add countries like South Korea, Vietnam, who are coming forward so rapidly, This is a new world, and that is why I call it the Asian century.
So when you think about the US, what part should the US be playing on the world stage over the next 4 years?
We have to hope profoundly that the US will go on playing a role as the main guarantor of freedom and democracy in the world. No one else is capable of playing that role. The US has had to sacrifice a lot to do it. It props up the free world. It pays a completely unfair share of defending the free world. And thank God it has. And one has to pray that it will continue to do so. And we have to pray that it won't follow the example of President Trump in turning your back on the rest of the world, of being mercantilist when it comes to trade, wanting to put up tariffs against everyone else and barriers, and be protectionist. We hope the United States will continue to be an outward-looking country which will want to play a full part, a leadership part in the world. The spirit of the US is in that and has been ever since the beginning of the Republic. So I'm optimistic, but there are dangers. I mean, President Trump had the support of a very large proportion of the American population. One cannot exclude the fact he'll want to run again in 4 years' time. And the same people who supported him now will support him then. And again, we should be faced with this question of a United States which wants to diminish its role in the world. But my advice is go to church or the mosque or somewhere every week and pray the United States will want to continue the role of being a leading world power, defending liberty, defending democracy. And I believe it will. I have great faith in the United States.
How important is the so-called special relationship to the UK, particularly in the current post-Brexit environment?
A lot of rubbish is talked about the special relationship nowadays. People say, oh, no, that's an old-fashioned concept. It's out of date and so on. Well, of course, it's evolved, but it is special. The relationship is special, partly because of our political cultures, partly because of our language, which people always say divides us more than it binds us, but actually the English language is a pretty good source of a relationship. What makes it special are the values, but above all, the intelligence and military relationship. That's always been close since the Second World War, and the various military forces are embedded with each other very often. The intelligence services are embedded with each other. The Americans feel they can share things with us, which they don't share with other countries, and we feel the same. We provide people to work in their intelligence agencies. They provide people who work very closely with us. And that makes the relationship special. Now, is Britain's voice in the relationship as strong as it would have been at the time of the Second World War? No. I mean, we are proportionately a smaller country. And when it looks to the rest of the world, the US has to look to China in a way which it didn't even 20 years ago. It has to look to Europe in a way which it wouldn't have done 40 years ago as being not a superpower, but at least an economic superpower. So the relationship is neither as exclusive or quite as privileged as it once was. But calling it special seems to me a perfectly sensible thing to do. It will remain important to us. It will remain as important after the pandemic as before. And any British government worth its salt works hard on preserving the special relationship because it knows how crucial it is to us. And just look back to the time, and I know I tend to harp on Margaret Thatcher, but that's where I spent so much of my working life. She understood it very well. She established a personal relationship with President Reagan that gave her quite exceptional influence over United States policy as a whole. Indeed, to the point when the American Foreign State Department, its foreign office, despaired of the amount of influence which Margaret Thatcher carried with the American president and her influence on American policy. And for us, that was a bonus, no doubt about it. Britain's voice was heard. We should always try to ensure that Britain's voice is heard in the United States.
What about business leaders? What vision do business leaders need to have in these times?
Well, business leaders have got to have very broad visions covering a huge number of different subjects. I mean, just to take one at random, cybersecurity. They have to have a vision of how they're going to deal with attacks on their technology, their business, their data, everything like that. That is part of it. They have to have a vision as to how they can flourish in e-commerce. One of the great effects of the virus has been the growth of e-commerce and the use of the internet and so on, and they need to be right up there with that. They need a vision of how they can make their businesses more digital, because that again is the way of the future. They're going to have to recognize that supply chains can become very vulnerable. You need to have different supply chains. You can't just depend on one country, one market for your supplies. You must be able to build alternatives. So there's going to be no shortage of a need for visions, and they're going to be complicated visions and technical visions. But above all, it's got to be a vision of maintaining free markets and encouraging governments to keep markets free, free of tariffs, free of obstacles of every sort. Galvanize governments into doing that. Governments don't naturally do it. They have to be bullied and pushed. The business is not always as active as it should be in doing that.
I'd like to pick up on the point around cybersecurity. And of course, we see, state actors active in this environment. As a former advisor on defense, what advice would you be giving to politicians and business leaders in that respect?
Well, the first advice is to take it much more seriously than it was for a long time. Now, the reason that it wasn't taken so seriously is this, really. It's all happened so quickly, but when the internet became a major thing, all the emphasis was on speed and connectivity. And that's where the emphasis has been ever since. Security lagged way behind. Oh, well, security will take account of itself in due course and so on. Well, that's not the case. Security now has to be right up the top of the pile because of the degree of attacks on companies and governments from, as you quite rightly say, both state actors and non-state actors. If countries know that if they attack you through the cyber world, you're going to do the same to them, then they'll have to think twice. And so that would be my vision of it for the future. Hugely greater emphasis by companies on cyber defense and greater activity by governments on deterring cyber attack by demonstrating that they can do the same, do as you would be done by.
Undoubtedly, one of the biggest challenges that the world is going to face or is facing and will become very much again on the agenda post the pandemic is climate change. Are we entering a new period of global cooperation with the US rejoining the Paris Agreement?
I think the answer to that is unqualified yes. If I'm optimistic about some things in the world, this would be one of the main ones. I think the message is finally getting through to all countries, all governments, and all societies. It's going to be hellishly tough, the things that people are going to have to pay for and put up with. But they're now coming to accept it. I mean, the United States has accepted the goal of net zero by 2050. The Chinese are now accepting net zero by 2060, and I think they would probably aim to beat that. And it's one area where I think the Chinese and the Americans can certainly talk together. And I hope that will become evident quite quickly. For God's sake, there's enough negative aspects to the relationship at present that this could and deserves to be one of the most positive ones. So yes, I am optimistic, and Britain is playing a big part in this too. We're hosting this big conference, global conference later this year, which we hope will take things a big step forward. You're seeing in this country, I only talk so much about Britain because this country obviously I know best, in renewable energies, which are now virtually all our electricity is now coming from renewable energy, and that's a huge step forward. We're fortunate having wind power because of our lousy climate, and some of the best wind in the world is either in the North Sea or in the Irish Channel, and so we are blessed in that. There's still an awful lot of work to be done on things like carbon pricing, but I think it's now recognised what the instruments are for dealing with climate change, and the political will is now emerging more strongly to actually use those instruments. Of course, it's getting a bit late in the day. We should have done it earlier. These things are not easy to get moving. Strangely, Margaret Thatcher was one who saw it very early on, but she was, again, because of her scientific background, I think, she gave speeches in the 1980s to the United Nations and to the Royal Society, pointing out the damage which we faced in the world. And if we didn't tackle global climate change, but like many prophets, she was a bit of a prophet in the wilderness at that time. When we hear that 2019 was the hottest year in history, it's brought home to people that this is actually happening now, and it's going to get worse. And there are grave dangers from unchecked climate change, dangers of huge population movements, dangers of new conflict over areas of the world which will become much more accessible. Think of the Arctic. With climate change and the melting of ice caps and so on, the Arctic is going to be accessible, and a lot of countries want to claim a stake to it. It's full of all sorts of minerals and goodies. And unless there's regulation of that, we shall have a new reason for conflict in the world.
Lord Powell, thank you so much for joining me today and sharing your insights.
It's been a pleasure, and thank you for the questions.